Any other doubt? You guys send us a quick report?
Adults had eight with $175, juniors two with $10, beginners four with $2, tops three, total attendance 17, total offering $187.
Alright, sing the song, Dan.
Number 137. $137.
When the trumpet and the horses and the times are seen no more, and the morning breaks the ground of bright air, when the sacred birds are gathered up around the gathering floor, and the rose of the ground will all be there. When the Lord
our offering this morning. Do we have any prayer requests to be mentioned of?
I'd like to remember my mama and my meemaw. My meemaw's going to the doctor tomorrow. She's got, her knee's been giving her some problems. And then my mama has not been feeling very well.
Any of it?
Meryl came through her surgery just fine. She's doing good.
Any of it? All right, let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, Lord, we bow before you this morning. Father, we are thankful that you have allowed us this opportunity, this privilege of being able to come to your house to be able to worship you and to learn of you this morning. Father, thank you for our service we've already had here today. Thank you for our lessons this morning. Father, as we continue to meditate upon those things, help us to keep our hearts open to your word that we might learn even more about you and grow up even closer to you than before. Lord, you've heard all these prayer requests made mention of here this morning. But Father, there are also many that are unspoken, but they're heavy upon our hearts. We have so many that we know of that are struggling, fighting, battling through different diseases, different illnesses, Father. Heal them, give them back their strength, help them build them. Father, if those that have lost loved ones, and comfort them. I'll help them be able to find the peace and strength that's in you in those times. Lord, do continue to bless this church and our ability to be a witness and a light for you here in our community. Help us be mindful of things that we need to be doing. Help us to have the grace and strength we need to accomplish them. Lord, do continue to be with this nation. Father, guide our leaders, help this upcoming election, help us to have leaders that will truly seek to do your will, that this nation might be able to turn to and seek you. Lord, we do ask that you would forgive us of our sins and of our shortcomings, for it's in Christ's name that we do pray. Amen.
Number 213, first and last.
Shall we gather at the river, where the driving the feet are broad? With its rhythm and river, will we find the throne of God? Yes, we'll gather at the river, the beautiful river. Gather with the saints at the river, let those by the throne of God. Thank you.
Bibles this morning. We are in the book of Romans, chapter 14. Romans 14, we're going to be reading beginning there in verse number 1. As Paul has addressed and looked at several different things about the Christian character, this 14th chapter brings us to one of the hallmarks, if you will, of what we are striving for. This chapter speaks of Christian maturity. You know, as you look around the world today, you know, it's easy to see that at times, you know, people become adults, but they never really grow up. You know, the difference in those two things. It's one thing to become an adult, it's another thing to actually grow up and to become mature and take responsibility and do those things that come with it. Well, as a child of God, there are a great many of God's people who may have been a child of God for a long time, but they've never really matured. They've never grown up. They've never advanced beyond the infancy or the early childhood, if you will, of being a child of God. You know, the Bible commands that we are not only to be saved, but that we're to grow. We are to be born again, and then we're to grow as a child of God. You're supposed to know more. You're supposed to act better. And you are supposed to be more mature, spiritually speaking, today than you were in the past. And what Paul deals with in this chapter is probably one of the most distinctive characteristics of a mature child of God, but it is also by far one of the most challenging aspects of being a mature child of God. This chapter, in many ways, speaks to a point where you can see a mature child of God and the impact that it has upon the church. And you also then begin to see also the problems that the lack of this spiritual maturity brings. It had the problem at Rome, but it had an even bigger problem at Corinth, because what Paul deals with in this chapter is something he also dealt with in Corinthians. It's also a problem he had in very many churches. It's still a problem that very much exists in our churches today. He says in verse 1, Romans 14, it says, "Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye, but not to doubtful disputations. For one believes that he may eat all things, another who is weak eats herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eats not, and let not him which eats not judge him that eateth, for God hath received him. Who art thou that judges another man's servant? In his own master he stands or falls. Yea, he shall be holden up, for God is able to make him stand. One man esteems one day above another, another esteems every day alike. Let every man be fully persuaded in his own mind. He that regards the day, regards it to the Lord. And he that regards not the day to the Lord, he doth not regard it. He that eats, eat it to the Lord, for he giveth God thanks. He that eats not to the Lord, he eats not, and giveth God thanks. For none of us lives to himself, and no man dies to himself. For whether we live unto the Lord. And whether we die to the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died and rose and revived, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. But why dost thou judge thy brother? Or why do thou set and not thy brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. For it is written, As I live, saith the Lord, every knee will bow to me, and every tongue will confess to God. So then every one of us shall give account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another, that anymore, but judge this rabbit, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. I know and am persuaded by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean of itself, but to him that esteemeth anything to be unclean, to him it is unclean. But if thy brother be grieved with thy meat, now walkest thou not charitably. Destroy not him with your meat, for whom Christ died. Let not then your good be evil spoken of. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness and peace and joy in the Holy Spirit. Him that is weak in the faith, receive, but not to doubtful disputations. This chapter brings before us a weak child of God and a mature child of God. And the first thing that we need to understand as we look at our verses this morning is the reception that takes place. The receiving of the weaker brother. Now, as you look at these verses, one of the important things to keep in mind about Paul's writings is really the world that Paul lived in at this time. Now, you and I live, in some ways, in a very almost post-religious world. You know, our world that we live in today, you have those who don't go to church, you have those that go to church. But in Paul's day, the bulk of the people that Paul talked to, when they came to know Christ, they came to that knowledge out of some form of religious background. That's not the way it is done today, but in Paul's day, when a person came to know Christ, they were maybe a Jew beforehand, a Jewish individual who was born and raised in the Jewish synagogues, who was taught the Jewish way of life and all the implications that came to that from their religious viewpoint. Most of the the Gentiles that Paul spoke to, when they came to know Christ, they came out of some form of paganism, some form of religious system. They all regarded the various Greek gods in some fashion or another. But they all came from these very religious backgrounds. And because of that, as they came to know Christ, they also carried with them the various understandings that came with it. You know, whether we want to think of it this way or not, all of us are impacted, and all of us are programmed, if you will, by things that were taught. And in Paul's day, you had these people who grew up thinking this is what religion is. This is how we worship God. This is how we serve God. This is what we need to do. And when they came to know Christ, many of them tried to worship God, but they were still impacted by the way they grew up and by the way they were raised. We still see much of this today. What Paul is dealing with in this chapter is a problem he would deal with on several occasions throughout the New Testament. But this comes back to the understanding that Paul is dealing with people who have come to know Christ. And they've come out of a lot of different backgrounds, with a lot of different practices, with a lot of different understandings of the way that things should be. And as you look at this chapter, we need to understand that, first of all, what Paul is dealing with here is not a doctrinal dispute. The issues that Paul is dealing with here is not an issue of salvation. He's not dealing with the doctrines of grace. He's not dealing with the doctrines of the deity of Christ or some great fundamental doctrine that Paul repeatedly said, you don't hold place with that. You know, Paul made it clear at times that those who don't hold to the core doctrines of Scripture, if they come to you and say that Jesus isn't God, you don't acknowledge them. Don't let them sit in the church. You deal with false doctrine. But not what this chapter is dealing with. What Paul is dealing with here is issues that were arising not off of necessarily scriptural differences, but upon different interpretations of how to handle certain things. And Paul wanted them to understand the way that things need to be. And much of this goes back to understanding the motive and the heart that they are to have. First of all, Paul said, him that is weak, we are to receive. As Paul is talking to the Romans here, the first things that we begin to see is that as the church was speaking, that they were to receive these weaker brethren that may not necessarily understand the way that things are. There are those who believed and those who taught that, well, the meat that you buy in the marketplace, not all of it, but much of it, came from the various pagan temples. The pagan temples were a place where they offered sacrifices to various gods, and then the meat that wasn't used in the actual sacrifice part is then taken, and it was sold in the marketplace. Okay, what? Well, not a big deal. You go out, and you buy this meat, and you eat it. Okay, not a big problem there. But many of the people in Paul's day didn't like that practice, because to them, they erased those temples. They erased in that worship, and they knew that that meat had been dedicated to a false god. And so they didn't want to take that meat. They said, well, that's like taking part in idolatry. That's like taking part in their idol worship. And I don't want to do it. And so they refused to do it. And so some wouldn't eat meat because they didn't want to take a chance of accidentally aligning themselves with these idols. And so they only eat herb. But then the Jews would say, well, that's ridiculous. Those idols don't exist in the first place. That's good meat. It's sold at a cheap price. So yeah, I'm going to buy it. And yeah, I'm going to eat it. And then you came to the problem of contention. Because now the two sides are arguing and they're bickering over. And this is where much of this chapter focuses, and it's where much of the same problem originated in 1 Corinthians, when Paul was dealing also with the issue of liberty. This dispute, this argument that was being done here. And what Paul speaks of in verse 1 here is that we are not to receive them, that we are to receive them, but not to the point of doubtful disputations. In other words, you don't bring these people in, you don't allow them to become part of the church simply so the fact of being that you can now argue with them and dispute with them and fight with them and contend with them daily about these various problems. Let not him that eats despise him that eats not. Let him which eateth not judge him that eateth. In other words, this issue of the eating of meat was not something that should have been divisive. This should not have been an issue that was dividing and splitting the church. You know, one of the great tactics that Satan has often used, and we see repeated throughout Scripture, is what? A house that's divided can't stand. And if you can get a church to arguing amongst itself and fighting amongst itself, most of the time over things that really don't matter a great deal, the church becomes divided, and the church becomes susceptible to the attacks of Satan, and they begin to stop doing what God has commanded them to do. Paul says, receive them. If they're a weaker brother, they don't necessarily understand the way things are. You know, they may know, but they may not fully understand. They may still be a young enough Christian that they aren't ready to accept the fact that I know that idol is false, I know it's not true, but I just can't accept that yet. I'm not mature enough yet. That still burdens me. That's the fact that I'm not going to do it. Don't argue with them over that. Don't do it to doubtful disputations. Don't bring them in and argue and fight over these things that do not matter. A child of God in the New Testament church should be far more concerned about building up a brother than tearing them down over things that do not, in the end, matter. For what did Paul say in verse 3? He said, not, well, verse 3, he said, for what? For God hath received him. God received them. So why aren't you? If God is willing to receive them, and God saved them by his grace, and God saved them by his mercy, and by the same shed blood that saved you, if God is willing to receive them, so should you. Paul tells them, he said, the weaker brethren in the faith, receive them, not to doubtful disputings, for God has received them as well. God did not accept you. God did not save you when you were perfect. God didn't redeem you because you're perfect and right. God saved you because you were a sinner. And neither do we say, God did not pardon you, and God isn't keeping you saved because you're perfect. God has saved you by his grace. He's keeping you saved by his grace. And we're all but sinners, striving to live for the Lord in this world. And we are to receive each other with that knowledge. You know, when you and I come together as a New Testament church, when we work in the Lord's house, it should always be about the understanding that, you know what? We're all just sinners. We're all sinners. We're all imperfect. We all have issues and problems that we're not going to agree with. We're not always going to agree on every minute detail. We're always going to have things to disagree with. But we should be striving to work together and building one another up and strengthening one another. A church that all they do is argue and bicker cannot be doing the work that's put before them. That's why it's so important that Paul speaks here about this issue of really a Christian maturity. The willingness at times to set aside personal preferences and personal likes for the advancement of the cause of Christ. If it's doctrine, yes, you stand for that. If they're standing there and telling you that salvation is by works, no, you don't accept that. You fight for that. You argue with that. And you plant your feet in the ground and you tell them that's not what the Bible says. And you're not teaching that here. We stand for that. But eating of meat offered to idols? What's the matter? As Paul would say to the Corinthians, he said the idol's not anything. The idol's just a statue that some person carved out of something, you know, wood or metal or something of that nature. 1 Corinthians 8, Paul says, concerning therefore the eating of those things offered and sacrificed to idols, we know that an idol is nothing in the world, that there is no other God but one. God doesn't exist, doesn't really matter. But if it's going to offend your brother, if it's going to cause your brother in Christ to suffer, if it's going to cause him to lose heart in the gospel, don't do it. The strength and the growing together in Christ is far more important. We are to receive the weaker brother, and not because they're perfect, not because they don't have problems, but because they are striving to live for the Lord. And we should be working together to mature and grow closer unto the Lord. We are to receive the weaker brethren. And we are to understand that not only are we to receive the weaker brother, but we are to understand that we serve the same master. We receive the weaker brethren, and we serve the same master. He said there in verse 4, who are you that judge another man's servant? To his own master he stands, or he falls. In verse 7, none of us live to himself, and no man dies to himself. Whether we live to the Lord. Whether we die to the Lord. Whether we live, therefore, or die, we are the Lord's. Why are you judging another man's servant? His own master, he stands, or he falls. One thing that you and I must never forget as a child of God is I'm not your master, you're not mine. But what we are is we're servants. We are all servants of the Lord Jesus Christ. We have one master, and his name is Jesus. There is one head of the church, and that's Jesus. We serve under his authority. All of us are here today because, first of all, hopefully anyway, we love the Lord. That's our first responsibility. We love God. And God, because God loves us. And we want to come together to worship him. I'm not here to judge you for your personal decisions and different things. You are answering to God. Now again, you must understand this in the light of Scripture. By that I mean the overall context here. Because again, what Paul is not dealing with here is church discipline. He's not addressing church discipline here. Paul deals with that in other places. Where he says, hey, this brother over here, he's living in fornication. You know, he's living with his stepmother. You know, this is sinful. Deal with that. You know, deal with it. If he won't repent in private, bring it before the church. Expel him from church membership. That way he might see the error of his ways and come back to Christ. And the overall view of Scripture, Paul says, when it comes to matters of morality, when it comes to matters of sin, the church has to deal with that. The church has the authority to look to its membership and say, hey, you're in sin. You're not coming to church. You need to come to church. Hey, you're in, you know, adultery. You're doing this or this sin over here. You need to watch yourself. You need to right the ship. And there are plenty of procedures and passages in Scripture that deal with the way that a church is to address this. You know, from, you know, going one person at a time and just trying to talk with them and then bringing, you know, witnesses with you and then eventually bring them before the church. So as you look at these verses, do not take this verse and then say where the Bible says I'm not to judge anybody. Because that's not exactly what Paul is saying here. Because Paul has made it clear there is a time to judge. There is a time to judge. There's a person who's qualified to judge. And that's there. But what Paul is dealing with here is judging a brother. Again, look at the context. Those who said they shouldn't eat meat. Well, guess what they were doing? They're looking at those who were eating the meat and saying, well, how could you? How could you do that? You're such an ungodly and immoral person. You're eating that meat, and don't you know that that meat was offered to a God, and so therefore it's idolatry? And they're judging that person because of it. And then the person who was on the other side of that one was looking at the person not eating meat and saying, how foolish are you? How angry, don't you know that idol's not eating? That idol doesn't exist. That's just a rock. That's just a stone that some man's head was God. And so they're judging that person. And they're saying, look how immature, look how irresponsible, look how downtrodden this person is. They're not passing judgment based upon the standard of Scripture and saying this is immoral or that's sinful. They're looking at one another and saying, you're not eating meat, and you should be. This one's saying, well, you're eating meat, and you shouldn't be. They are judging and condemning one another. And they're passing this judgment upon one another. And in the end, all you have now is squabbling, quarrels, and division. Over what? Salvation? Nope. Over meat. Offered not. Paul rebuked the church at Corinth extensively over this matter. The church at Corinth was dividing up into all sorts of factions over and groups over all sorts of different items that were there. Paul here says, we are not to judge another man's servant. When it comes to the matters of the conscience, such as eating idols, God's the judge. And let God be the judge of that person's heart. This was not an issue that should have been dividing and separating the church. For we all serve one master. If one man esteems a day above another, and one says, all right, let him be fully persuaded his own mind. In other words, you sit down. And if in your heart you determine to yourself and you say, you know what? I know that idol's not anything, but I don't want to eat that meat. I just can't bring myself to do it. And so you make yourself out. I'm not going to do it. You make a personal choice. Now, by personal conviction, and you don't do it. Then you don't go ramrod it around down anybody else's throat and say, you're going to do it this way, because this is what I think. This is the person who says, I'm going to eat meat and like it, shouldn't be forcing it down the other person's throat. There is to be a point where we as God's children, we do not force other people's to accept our preferences. That's what. If you make a personal choice in your mind to do something, good. Hold to your convictions. But if it's not a doctrine specifically stated in Scripture, you're simply trying to force other people to do it. If you want to, and so that's what Paul says here. To those who, let's see, one man a day above another, good. Be fully persuaded and convicted in your own mind. If you regard the day, regard to the Lord. And if you choose to eat, eat it for the Lord. For he gives good, for he gives God thanks, and he eats not to the Lord, he eats it not for the God give, but giveth God the thanks for it. They are to understand the day. You know, in Paul's day, that was the two major disputes. It was over diet, and it was over the various days, especially for those coming out of Judaism. Do you keep the Sabbath day? Do you keep the Passover? Do you keep all these various holidays, various feast days at the end? Anybody wonder, you either regard the day or not. Paul said if you regard the day, you choose to do so for your own personal benefit, okay. We're not under the law. You don't have to keep the Sabbath day today. But if you make a choice in your mind that you know what? I'm not going to do anything on the Saturday because it's the Sabbath day of the Lord. So I'm going to set this day aside and let it be a day of rest to me. I'm going to take this day to just kind of separate myself and pray and study the Word of God. Go for it. All power to you. You know, but make that choice in your heart and in your mind and do it. But it is to be your choice. That's not something you are to force upon another because the Bible doesn't say you have to do it. There are many things that a child of God can choose to do that are good, that are beneficial, that might be spiritually better for you. But that doesn't mean you have to force anybody else to do it. If you think it's good that you want to fast on a certain day of the week, good, do it. So there's rules to govern that. But you can't force anybody else to do it because the Bible doesn't say we have to do it. There are things in the Word of God you and I must understand that we may be fully persuaded in our own minds, but they're a matter of conscience. And so we must be mindful of these things and realize that we all serve God. And we should not be judging others based upon their preferences of conscience. Now, again, we may, as a church, have to judge certain people because of sin, because that's what the Bible commands. But Paul here isn't dealing with matters of sin, he's dealing with matters of conscience. Those things aren't necessarily forbidden in Scripture, but we need to be mindful of them. Why? Because we do not live to ourselves. We live unto the Lord. That eighth verse is a verse that all of us should understand because it is repeated in numerous times throughout the New Testament. It's worded in a lot of different ways. It's parsed in different ways, but it's the same message that Paul says over and over again. We live unto the Lord. If we live, we live unto the Lord. That is supposed to be our goal. We realize that all of us are serving the same master, and we are living unto him. Paul would say that for me to live is Christ, for me to die is gain. Why? Because he is living for the Lord. We are to lay our lives at the altar of sacrifice. We are to present our bodies a living sacrifice to the Lord. Paul said in Galatians, I am crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. In the life I live, I live henceforth by the power of the Son of God, who died for me. Why? Because our life is now the Lord's. My life, your life, is to be dedicated to serving God. God has given me eternal life. God has redeemed my soul. So therefore, now I am going to live for him. What matters most is the Lord. What is to be our goal is the Lord, not me, not my personal wants, not my personal ambitions, not what makes me look the best. But the Lord should be first. Most church arguments and disputes would be resolved if the church members simply understood what matters most is the Lord. My personal likes and thoughts don't matter. What matters is the Lord and how we may best promote the Lord Jesus Christ, worship him, and how that we as a church might be able to grow stronger together worshiping him. It's about church unity that leads to church maturity as we worship God. My personal likes and dislikes don't really matter as much as it does promoting Christ, building him up, enjoying worshiping Christ, and us growing closer together and becoming closer and more maturely drawn to him. A child of God should have no problems setting aside their own personal wants if it means that the gospel can be advanced. Do you know what? When we all start setting aside our own personal wants to advance Christ, all of a sudden a lot of these little problems don't really matter as much anymore. You know what? I don't really think you should eat meat offered to idols. But you know what? If you eat that doesn't bother you, go for it. It'll be okay. We're working to serve Christ. If we live unto the Lord, whether we die, we are to live unto him. Why? Because we were all serving the same master. We can all receive the weaker brethren, and we should, not to dispute, not trying to judge them and to beat them down, but we receive them to help them grow. And we realize that at times we may be the weaker brother. And we realize that we are all to be serving the same master. We are to receive the weaker brother, knowing that we all serve the same master, and also to understand that we are also going to stand before the same judge. Verse 9, Paul says, to this end Christ died, that he might be Lord both of the dead and the living. So why are you judging your brother? Why do you set it not your brother? For we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ. As it is written, as I live, says the Lord, every knee shall bow to me, every tongue shall confess to God, so that every one of us shall give account of himself to God. Let us not therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this rather, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. I know and am persuaded by the Lord Jesus that there is nothing unclean in itself, but to him that esteemeth anything to be unclean, to him is unclean. But if your brother be grieved with your meat, now walkest thou not charitably, destroy not him with your meat, for whom Christ died. We are to live understanding and knowing that we are going to one day stand before the Lord Jesus Christ. One day we are going to stand and we are going to be judged for the life that we have lived, and we are going to be judged by the works that we have done. Now, Paul here is not talking about the judgment of the lost. That's dealt with in other passages. What Paul is dealing with here is the judgment of the saved. And the fact that one day every lost person will stand before God, but one day every child of God is going to stand before God one day. So we're going to bow down. We're going to confess who he is. One day we are going to stand before God. We will see Christ as he is. In all the splendor and all the glory and all the magnificence that he is. And we're going to be judged. As a child of God, you were given a new life. You were given a new birth. You were given a new nature at salvation. And now we are responsible for living for the one who has given us all of these things. Because one day we're going to stand before him. God, Christ, is our ultimate judge. Why are you judging your brother? We're all going to stand before Christ one day, and we're all going to be judged. And one of us, and all of us, are going to give account of himself to God. As a child of God, all of us should be living our lives with that realization, with that understanding. In Jesus' day, Jesus spoke at times about the idea of a servant who would go off, whose master went off on a long journey, and he came back, and the master called the servant to account. You know, a servant or a steward is someone who is given accountability. He was given responsibility over something from his master, and then at some point in time, his master called an account for that. If it was financial, then he had to be ready because that master may say, all right, I want to see the book. You know, give me the number. Let me see what you've done. You know, he might glance at it or he might look at the details. You got it all lined up correctly. You and I are but stewards of the graces that God has given to us. And one day everything that we've done is going to be laid bare before. Every action, every thought, every idle word, everything is going to be laid bare and brought into account before him. We're all going to stand, and then we're all going to be judged. Every one of us is going to give account of himself to God. Every single one of us ought to look at our lives and realize that first of all, we thank God for his grace. Because if not for the righteousness of Christ upon my account, then my account would immediately send me straight to the pits of hell. The only reason I'll be able to stand in the judgment seat of Christ one day, and not the great white throne of judgment, the only reason why I will be able to know that I know assuredly today that one day I will enter the courts of heaven and spend eternity with Christ is because God saved me by his grace and because when I repented of my sins and placed my faith in Christ, Christ's righteousness was placed upon my account. And when God sees me, he sees the righteousness of Christ, therefore I'm saved. Because if I had to stand before God my own righteousness, by my own actions, I would stand condemned. Well, Paul said in Philippians 3, he said, being found in him, not having my own righteousness, which is according to the law, but the righteousness of Christ, which is by faith in him. But yet one day, as a child of God, we're going to stand before him, we're going to give account. A lot of us are going to have a lot of wood, and a lot of hay, a lot of stone that have been placed upon that judgment rock. And one day, that very little was going to be left to show for those things. God gave us life. God gave us opportunities to serve him and to do much in his work. And one day we're all going to have to give account for the way that we handle those opportunities. Give account for the things that we have done in this life. And one of those areas that we're going to be judged for is because, as Paul said here in verse 15, he said, don't therefore judge one another anymore, but judge this, that no man put a stumbling block or an occasion to fall in his brother's way. I believe that all of us, if we truly at times understood just the number of times that we may have done things or said something or done some action that caused another brother to stumble, it probably would break our hearts. You know, at times we may know of particular instances, but it's the ones we don't know about that probably break our hearts even more. You see, the biggest problem that the church at Rome had was of all these disputes that they had, all of this arguing and bickering and fighting over meat offered to idols and over whether you should eat meat or not. It was bringing, first of all, a bad reputation upon the church because now people sat there and went, I don't want to go over there. All they ever do is argue. You know, all they ever do is argue and fight over things. Now, we don't want to go and take a part in that one. And then you have the children of God are sitting in the church house who might literally be this immature child of God, who's sitting there genuinely wanting to learn, genuinely wanting to grow in Christ, who then hears all of this and says, This is stupid. I don't want any part of it. All they ever do here is fight. I'm doing it on my own. And they leave the church house. Maybe we never come back. I've known people who would tell you that. I tried to go to church, but it just didn't work out. They argued too much. I don't go back. That church is going to be held accountable for that. If they make me a child of God, they're going to have to give account for the fact that their actions kept people from being able to serve the Lord. Because the Bible says we're to love one another. And we are to strive to help each other grow and increase in faith and strength. And far too many of God's people and far too many of the Lord's churches have driven a lot of people away from serving Christ. We are not to make ourselves a stumbling block or give an occasion to fall. We should not be those who are leading people into sin. And we should not be those who are leading people to stumble and to falter in their faith. This world is full of temptations. This world is full of hardship. This world is full of things that can pull and drive a child of God away from serving Him. According to the parable of the sower, there's a great many of God's people who are choked out by the tears of this life. But one thing that should not lead a child of God away from serving the Lord is another child of God. Does it happen? Yes, but it shouldn't. You and I, the child of God, should be careful to maintain our lives that we do not become the reason why somebody else stops serving God. We need to be careful that we are not the reason why somebody else falls into sin. You and I understand sin, or we should. We understand its power. We understand its devastation and its consequences. And we should not be striving to do anything that might lead a child of God into sin or a lost person to stay in their sin. We should not be wanting to live a lie or living and conducting ourselves in a way that makes another brother stumble and stop growing in faith. A mature child of God is one who's going to be able to look at their life and say, I can do this, I want to do this, but I'm not going to. Because if I do, then that brother right there, whoever he may be, it's going to hurt his conscience. And it's going to keep him from being able to pay attention. It's going to keep him from being able to grow in Christ. So I'm going to set this aside. I'm not going to do it. Because to me, his maturity is more important than my personal wants. This is where the Romans were failing. This is where Corinthians failed. Where so many of us fail. If we're a mature child of God, we're going to be able to look at people and say, you know what? I could do this, but it might lead this person down the wrong path. So I'm not going to do that. We should be willing and strive to live that sort of life. Because one day we're going to have to give an account. One day you and I are going to stand before God and give account for the works that we've done. One day we're going to give an account for all the things that we didn't do that we were supposed to do. We're going to give account for the actions and the life that we've lived. We are not to be a stumbling block to our brothers and sisters in Christ. We are not to be those who cause them to fall and to falter into sin. We are to be those who should be striving to help one another to grow closer to God and become more stronger in the faith. Paul said there in verse 15, if your brother agree with your meat, then you walk not charitably. Destroy not him with your meat, for whom Christ died. In other words, Paul said, if you're eating meat and it's grieving your brother, it's causing him to stumble, then you're not walking in love. So don't do it. And destroy not him with your meat. Don't allow your preferences, don't allow those items to be what causes somebody else to falter and to stop serving God. As a child of God, we are going to stand before Him as judge and be judged one day. You and I, as the children of God, as the New Testament church, we are to receive the weaker brother. We are to bring those in who may be weak, perhaps immature in the faith, and we are to strive to help them to grow closer to God and to learn more about Him and how to grow closer to Him. We are to receive them as Christ received them. And we are to receive them knowing that we serve the same master, that we all are striving to serve God, that God is to be foremost, and our preferences come secondary, that God is to be first. We live unto the Lord, and we are to receive them knowing that we are all going to stand before the same judge, that one day we're all going to be judged, and we should not be living lives that drive people away from serving God. We should be living lives that are drawing people closer unto Him. Whether we live or we die, let us live unto the Lord, one that we are all going to stand before and give account. May we be striving today, the child of God, to provoke Christ in all things, to help each other to grow closer unto Him. For the kingdom of God is not meat and drink, but righteousness, peace, and joy in the Holy Spirit. Well, let's have a word of prayer this morning. Heavenly Father, Lord, thank you so much for allowing us the privilege, the opportunity of being able to come to your house to be able to worship you here today. Father, thank you for the privilege, for the blessing of being able to be called your children. Father, we know that we are but sinners, but yet you chose to love us. You showed your love to us as sinners because you allowed your Son to die upon the cross of Calvary, that by his shed blood we could have the forgiveness and the remission of our sins. And Father, help us to live lives that are honoring of that, and that shows that to the world around us. Father, we know that we have a great need to be putting you first, so that you be the motive, so that you be the guide that we have in everything that we do. Father, help us to live and to truly strive to put you first in all things. So, Father, it is in Christ's name that we do pray. Amen. If you will stand, we'll have just a verse invitation this morning. You're here this morning, and perhaps you are a child of God. Perhaps you're at a point in your life where you understand that you are a born-again child of God, but maybe you're out of fellowship with God. Perhaps you have some burden, some needs you need to lay before. Or perhaps you are here, but you're not a child of God. Perhaps you are a lost sinner. Perhaps you know that you are a sinner. You know you're condemned to hell, but you've never accepted Christ. Whatever your needs are, if you come and sing just a verse of invitation this morning.
Number 125.
Good to see everybody. I made it out to services this morning. It is Fifth Sunday, so we do have lunch over in the fellowship hall. Everybody stay, eat. There's plenty of food over there. Anything else before we dismiss? Hearing nothing then. Brother Randy, you dismiss us in prayer, please.
Kind of dressed as a follower of the temple.